So this room is very much like a room that we have at our lab at McMaster. We have an observation window. We've got kind of a living room set up. And the idea here is to provide kind of an organic environment where play might take place, and we might be able to observe people in their natural habitat, or they may forget that they're not in their natural habitat. There are a couple of... Let me actually pull out my... So my lab is both an industry lab and an academic lab. A lot of the stuff that I do... Come on in.
Yeah, so the two one-to-one rooms are right over here. One of these two social rooms.
So... The protocols in the lab where I'm at is we're actually in a innovation park, but we're also part of a university. And Canada paid for our funding, but our purpose is to work with industry partners. So there's kind of a mixed bag of what our role is. So typically the way an academic research project comes about is that we have to go through a process of protecting both our subjects as well as the university from liability. So we begin by going through a process where we're writing up what we're going to do before we're going to do it. And we have to guarantee that everybody is going to be treated the same way with standardization. Everybody is going to be safe. Their data is going to be safe, and we're going to conduct ourselves in an upright fashion. And once we've shown that, we get an ethics clearance. So ethics in the United States is called human subjects, or our internal review board. So you submit the research, a packet like this. This is an example of a study for brain fitness games. And the idea is it's twofold. One is we want to actually improve the experience of playing through these games. And another one is that we want to see whether or not the subgroup of games that we've chosen actually yields an outcome such as improved spatial reasoning. So what we've done is we've designed an experiment along with collecting user experience data. So it may represent a little bit different purpose than a lot of labs, but it combines a little bit of everything. So why do you do it? So this morning I got into my uncle's daughter's high school car, which I'm visiting, coming back. And as I got my coffee this morning, my Uncle Bob said, you know, you should really get a lid from that, for that. And I said, oh, it'll be okay. Cue forward half an hour. I'm on 880. I'm telling my phone what to do. And I go like that. And it's in the cup holder. And the thing about it is, I knew what the proper protocols were when I left the house this morning. Now I've got a phone that's bricked, right? And I'm on 880 trying to find this place across the bridge. So what do? I realize, oh, this is a great case in point or example of why it is that we put together these protocols and why it is that we standardize across, is because we have some prediction of what's going to happen each time that we deliver a stimulus, right? Something that we're going to collect data from. So using this form, what we want to do is create, and this is kind of just a generic, is create kind of generic protocols in order to not only invite people in, get them settled, create the protocols that we're going to use with our participants, debrief them, and then what we're going to do with the data afterwards. So that's kind of a general overview of how the lab works. Would you like to go to questions, or would you like me to demonstrate how I would typically bring somebody in and get them settled? This is supposed to be a very practical, practical session. So the first thing that I thought would be I could just respond to your questions or what you're curious about.
Are there any analog games that Sony does that they...
I'm not with Sony. I'm with McMaster University.
Right. Okay. So in a situation where you're doing analog games, is this situation, this current environment, applicable? Is it adaptable?
When you say analog, do you mean like board games or dice games?
Yeah, any of those. Because it's the same, you know, you bring them in to test it out, it's the same scenario, you want to get the same information.
Well, that's where you're going to begin to look here. Is you're going to begin thinking about your session setup. And when you're thinking about your setup, actually, you didn't get one of these, did you? So, when you're beginning to think about your setup, you're going to want to think about, for example, what you're looking to gain through user feedback. So, one of the issues in user experience is that you can't design user experience, you can observe it. So what you're looking at is how people interact with your product or your system or each other in the context of your observation, right? So what you have to decide is how you're going to collect that data. And whether you do it in a room like this, or for example, I'm often working with vulnerable populations in the wild also. Like this brain fitness test, I'm actually going to be in middle school classrooms observing them using tablets. So what I have to do is figure out how am I going to collect this data, and how am I going to align my observations with the purpose for the study? Because what I want to do is I want to both design an experiment where I have clear variables that are defined based upon the outcomes that I want to examine, and I want to examine whether or not how those variables, one, inform the design and flow of the actual game. So one of the issues that we designed in the brain fitness game was, how are we going to get these kids to keep playing these games? Because in many cases, they're like old arcade games that are like Asteroids and other things that, like Tetris, that depend upon spatial reasoning. How are we going to get them to play them over and over? Because we actually have to have a certain repetition of play over time in order to have reasonable data from each play in order to compare with sessions over time within and across subjects. So, how are we going to get them to play them more than once? How are we going to get them to play them for so many hours? And that comes into the user experience piece, because for this brain fitness product to be valid and reliable in its measures, it actually has to have so much playing time. So how do we get the kids to continue playing this game? And the second piece is, if they do play this game for an extended period of time, does it actually lead to any results? So in this case, what we're trying to do is double dip, which is to validate the instruments as well as to improve the amount of play. So with that in mind, the type of variables that we've set up have been, well, let's look at the value of feedback in providing these games. And we, rather than just using a pure user approach, we're interested in, well, how does goal orientation affect people's engagement? So the more feedback that you give them, quality feedback about their progress through the game, does that elicit more engagement? Does that sustain engagement? And then we can look at the different types of feedback that provide. Also, what we want to do is say, okay, here are some cognitive instruments that we can use to test spatial reasoning. We're going to have them do them before, we're going to have them do it in the middle, and then at the end, we're going to do a comparison for a growth model. And we're going to have another group play a game not related to the spatial reasoning, compare them, take the same tests, switch them, and see if there's a difference. Thus, the way that we design the experiment or the user experience, so going back to your question, when you're thinking about an analog game or any type of game, what you want to begin doing is thinking about, well, what kind of data do I want to collect and for what reason? And that goes into how you set up, you do your setup. So in a situation like this, we might want to be able to watch somebody in the wilds, for example, figure out how to start the game. We might want to look at how a couple sits and plays together. Or we might want to sit and watch how does a party game work. And even if we're not using a video game or a platform, like we have a game board in the middle, we might want to look at, well, how do they take turns in the context of this game? How does in-game communication happen? How is that facilitated by the board? And then we can create target variables within the flow of the gameplay and collect those either through video collection, audio collection, observation through the glass. So those types of analytics as well. So even though you're not collecting on a screen through capture, you can still capture the observed performance.
Right.
So it's still applicable. So I view that as a form of ethnography, is looking at the cultural, cognitive, rule-based behaviors based upon space, cognition, and time. Those are the three main factors in ethnography to observe. So I look at causal relationships. There are tools that I use called a causal network analysis, where before I've actually started the game or given the game, I've done an analysis of the playthrough, and I've looked at the different decision nodes that happen here so that I can map those out and look at behavior in the course of the game, and I can say, this is what we expected to happen here, much like we would expect in a video game for in-game telemetry. You can do that with a board game too, knowing that the flow of the game should move based upon the rules in this fashion.
Okay. Thank you.
Vulnerable populations, that's one of my specialties, so I work a lot with children. I'm also working with seniors, like with mild cognitive impairment, early stage Alzheimer's, so going to facilities. So also learning to work with those populations and making sure that by standardizing, you assure that the processes that you have in place are not only there for their protections, but also give you more valid and reliable data and much more replicable. So there are training procedures that go into, once we've created our session and we have our checklist, and we start thinking about the facilitation. So if we go, so in the studies that I do with vulnerable populations, you need a script. Because oftentimes I'll have students that are working in the lab that are getting training to eventually work in a place like Sony, where you work. And what we want to do is we want to make sure that the way the script is presented is similar across participants. Because the way that you say it can change people's interpretation and response to how they interpret what's been said. So the way that this is said is important. So my first job ever doing user research was an accident. I was at the Xerox PARC Research Center on an internship from De Anza College. My first job was with an online card catalog from the library. And what I found is that the data that I was collecting was not very good. People were not engaged. And then I discovered, hey, this is a lot like Battleship, because what I was doing is giving them certain types of searches in order to find objects within the database. And I thought, this is like Battleship. So I started changing the way that I facilitated the script and told them about the activity. And they started to enjoy searching for things in the database. I thought, I'm getting much better data here. I'm having fun. They're having fun. And it changed, it switched the script on how things were working. They weren't feeling worn down, I wasn't feeling worn down, they were much more willing to go into the data with me. The key is being able to replicate that across people who are actually leading the participants through the data collection. Another key practical item is the participant paperwork. So if you have, for example, a survey, I worked in a driving lab called Human First. We had a full-size Saturn in the 360 theater simulating road conditions. And oftentimes we would give them inventories beforehand. Like one study, we wanted to see if we could get people to have road rage. Talk about a great study. We set up a driving condition where you had a minivan and a station wagon going back and forth like that in the 65 zone, both doing 54 miles an hour. And you had to get from point A to point B to pick up your kids. And people were losing their mind. And I thought, this is the greatest job ever. you're collecting this paperwork beforehand, and it's really important to have a standardized system for when you collect that paperwork and how you present take the paperwork, how you collect it. If you have a standardized format, if anybody comes to question about how you did what you did, you say, here is the script. Here is how I did this. Here is how it was collected. Here is how it was stored. In our lab, we have assent forms and consent forms and information form, our letters of interest. So one of the first things that we do is we go over the letter of interest. And then if it's a minor or a vulnerable population, we'll go through the assent form. And if there's the guardian is present, we'll also go through consent. So we'll have to have them actually sign these are examples of assent and consent forms. That's the letter information that would be initially presented in the recruitment. Then we have the consent, where they're signing off and saying, I understand what's being collected in this study, I understand how you're going to save my information, I understand how you're going to use it. And then we have the assent, which means that, especially with vulnerable populations, you need to be very clear and you need to be able to describe it to a five-year-old. And putting that in terms that they can understand, so that when they sign it, they say, I did understand what you were asking me to do. And the worst thing that can happen is for you to feel like you did something untoward with a child or a vulnerable population, where they feel like they've been in some way wronged, and you feel terrible afterwards thinking, how could I have done this better? And this is one of the values of standardizing a process, not only that you can describe and you can say this is the system, and also that can be replicated across your staff.
I have another question.
Yeah.
So when you're describing some of these outcome type studies with vulnerable populations, are you working with finished products then and seeing the impact, or do you have products that you can influence some of the design changes?
Both. So that's why the question about analog is very interesting as well. So when we start talking about discount usability or write type usability, where we're beginning to do paper and pencil and tabletop representations of game mechanics and such, we can actually do fairly agile, lightweight user studies, and we can collect data and we can do running records right on the fly, and we can begin to change the design in an iterative fashion and do it with a very light footprint. So that we can. So part of the value of that is I did a lot of internal IT where the outcome was not marketed. It was something that was implemented within the company. And that type of return on investment analysis is very different, because you don't have a market to say, how did it do financially? What you have to be able to do is measure then what was the impact on performance within the organization. So in order to do those types of measures, you want a very clear method for measurement within the software to know what the impact was. And if you can build that beforehand with these kind of agile, lightweight tests beforehand, you can save a lot of money and a lot of time and a lot of sanity before you develop the first prototype. Because once you have that prototype, structurally, if you haven't asked the right questions, and typically nobody has the right questions when you begin. So your subject matter experts might believe that this is what you're supposed to be modeling. Your designers say this is what you're supposed to be modeling. And then you get your users in. And what people forget is you're not the user. And what their goal orientation is for your game may change the way that your game comes out or the way that your software comes out. So being able to conduct these kind of user tests early on in a lightweight manner with potential users, that can save you a lot of money. I used to work construction in the summer too, and there was a saying by some of the old guys, they said, blueprints, plans, who cares? There's always time to build it twice. And of course, that costs a lot more money when you have to retool and restructure. And so if we can actually do that in kind of an iterative agile process, it's actually may take a little longer, but in the end it costs less. And it doesn't actually take longer. You're just doing more upfront work.
Right.
And that's the idea behind this, is the more that you can kind of organize before you bring people into the lab, the better. And when you have them come in, it doesn't mean it's all set in stone. What it means is that you have a good framework to start with, that you thought your target variables were these, but now in looking at this tape, maybe we need to go a different direction with this. Maybe we need to pivot here because we're getting a lot different response than we want. And maybe this is actually the way to go. And you don't want to be too far in development when you make that kind of decision, right? So if you can do that early on, you save a lot of anger and preserve people's sanity as well as your budget.
You work with minors a lot. Is it difficult to stick to a script when you're moderating with minors? Like, how do you kind of keep them on track without influencing their reactions and opinions?
It's like herding cats. I have a lot of experience with young people. My initial training, like my first internship, was with Xerox. Then I worked at Oracle. But then I left that field completely, and I became a middle school teacher for 10 years. And what I began, that experience has really helped inform my understanding of how to work with kids. And what I've tried to really bring across is that developing curriculum is very much like developing research. What you're doing is you're developing assessment tools. And you can't predict how your user is going to respond to them. But what you can do is be sure of your design elements. And that is, if the design is this, and you expect this kind of outcome, this is what you'll expect to happen. If different things happen, that's kind of exciting. Mm-hmm. Like, so I was a teacher educator at the University of Minnesota for a while. And a story was bringing in a mathematician to a fourth grade class. And classroom management is a big deal. And this guy walks in and says, "Hi, kids. I'm Crazy Herb, and I love math, and I love to dance." And he said, "Let's dance." And they all danced, and it was great. And about 35 minutes later, they got the class to calm down, but then it was pretty much over. So you have to kind of understand your population as well and realize that there are predictable outcomes to the things that you put in front of people. And what you want to do is increase the certainty of those outcomes based upon the contingencies that you plan for. So if you believe that this type of stimulus is going to promote this kind of response, one of the interesting pieces then comes, what if I vary this a little bit? Should I get a different response? And then it becomes a very much experimental process where you can say, I can actually engineer people's behavior in interesting ways through design. And not only can you be user-centered, but you can also start bringing in theory and also statistical data from research. So if you were doing a game on depression, how are you going to begin to diagnose whether or not the person has depression? How are you going to be able to test whether or not certain types of stimulus actually improve the quality of life for that person within the game? And how are we going to show that they transfer outside of the game? And it becomes a really interesting process of if then, then this, if that, then this. And it's one of the reasons I really enjoy it, is in many ways I'm setting up the game before I'm having people play it. And whether it's analog or whether it's digital, I really need to be clear about what I'm trying to gather. And there are methods. So, for example, using a phenomenological interview, I may not have my intervention set up. For example, I may be interested in a phenomenological paper that I thought was really great, was women's experience buying blue jeans. And women are very particular about their cuts of jeans because women want to look good. But they also can be kind of sensitive to it. So what are their real experiences? Well, if you go in and start priming with certain types of questions, you're going to get certain types of answers. But if you say, so have you ever bought blue jeans? You're getting a yes, no question, right? You can change that and say, so tell me, what is your experience of buying blue jeans? And you're getting these open-ended questions that can complement these more controlled pieces. And you can begin to integrate these more free-flowing types of methodologies into these much more controlled methodologies. So my thinking in putting together this session was, what's really important is the planning that you do leading up to it. And what it does is it provides you with a very clear beginning as far as how you want to collect data. And your data, for example, working at a game company, the questions will be shaped by the designers and developers if you're working within a specific user research group. And they may say, we're really curious about, for example, I was at the Skywalker talk this morning, we're really interested in the way kids respond to the character artwork here. And, okay, well, let's find out about that. Well, if I use some of these open methodologies as well as the observations that have analytics behind them, have a very nice mixed method or multi-method model in order to triangulate and do cross-checking or balancing against what are my assumptions based on this data, what are my assumptions based on this data, and it can inform my development process. And that those questions then go back to the data then goes back to the developers, and you may not interpret it for them, but you may say, based upon your questions, here was the design. The design was intended to elicit these types of outcomes to answer your questions. This is what we found. Here were some interesting things that went along with it as corollaries that you might be interested in. And then it's taking your artifacts, such as your surveys, your observational data, your running records of what you observed. I mean, I had a great time writing down all the profanities in that driving study. I mean, there was some really creative work in there. And then you're taking your own observations, and also then, you know, if you've got a time series, you can say, here is a good target. So if you're using a piece of software like iMotions or Moray, or you've got an in-house capture system, you can say, hey, something really interesting happened here. This is what I remembered saying. I'm going to hit the button here, and that goes in your summary at the end to say, go to the tape in the database and look at 3 minutes and 40 seconds. And they say something really profane here that I think you'll find is funny, or in the case of the driving study. So I think that the more organized you are, the more freedom you actually have. And that sounds counterintuitive, but in many ways, like any type of design situation, you need requirements or restraints, and I think of it as like being put in a plain cardboard box. And the first thing that I want to do is push against the walls, and it reminds me of when I was in kindergarten and my mom brought home the book of all the things you can do with a cardboard box. And it's those constraints, it's those things that you push against that I think provide you the greatest freedom, because when somebody questions, well, what were your methods? You have very clear methods to point to, and you can say, this can be easily replicated by another lab. Remember when cold fusion was a big deal? What was it, 8, 9 years ago out of the University of Utah? Nobody could replicate it. And the importance of replication is that what your findings say, other people can also find. And when you're talking to your team and saying, this is the data. Well, how do you know that's right? Well, seeing is believing. Well, if there's somebody on the team that knows something about methods, they can say, well, you know, I could see how this would come out in a lot of situations. How did you control for that? And you really want to have an answer for that, and you want to show them that's a really good observation, and I thought about that. That's a really good thing to be able to say, right? That's a great observation, and I thought about that. This is how I handled it. So, as a practical approach to bringing people into a room like this, you really want to have standard protocols that you can fall back on and that you can replicate not only across people delivering the study, but also in how you collect the data and how you interpret it and how you share it. I feel bad. I've been doing a lot of talking, and I feel like there's probably a lot of knowledge already in here. So anybody else use a room like this?
No. My settings are more, we don't do a lot of TV or video game stuff, but we'll sit people down in front of their laptops or something like that. So it's not as like family room style oriented, but we do studies with like mostly website usability. So it's more like at a table, and you're sitting at a desk, and the moderator's sitting at the desk as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But yeah, this is all good stuff. It's very applicable to have that concrete setup to give both to your client and to present to when you're moderating. Because I'm kind of new at moderating, but trying to keep things consistent between people, I find difficult because it's like people have different reactions to the same stimulus. It's somebody gets lost on a website, and I have to kind of direct them back, but I also don't want to lead them. So those are the difficulties that I face.
Do you create a researcher persona?
Yeah, it's a different attitude than I take talking to someone one-on-one, I guess. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of questions that you want to encounter, that you would encounter, and for a lot of the questions that you can think of before the experiment, do you have scripted answers so that when you do give an answer to questions that you expect, that you're giving everyone that same answer and seeing if that answer works for everyone kind of thing? Or is the answer kind of like a free open, see what you want?
Well, I think that when you're working with a team of developers, they're going to have focused questions. And they're going to ask you a more general thing is, where are the bottlenecks in this level that I've been at? And then you can look at your analytics and you can look at your user play. Or they might ask you about, are we switching?
It's about that time. There's some new people interested, but
oh,
keep
cool.
on going. So we've got two sessions.
Working a friend of mine at Microsoft is a user experience designer, and another friend is a user researcher. And the user researcher is told these are the problems that we want to address, or these are the things that we want to know about the UI that we've created. And the user researcher says this is how we're going to try to address those questions. And these are some of the responses that we had. This is kind of what we expected based upon the sample population and what we've observed elsewhere. And this kind of gets into an important idea where in a lot of cases we have theories, and there's a lot of psychological theory about why people do what they do. But we also have statistical constructs that are grounded in doing lots of sampling and seeing what are the characteristics of people. So one example of that is the DSM-5, which is one of the ways that we characterize a diagnosis in a non-theoretical way. So in order for a child to be diagnosed with ADHD, they need to hit certain criteria within the construct. The same with depression, schizophrenia, bipolarism. So when we have these constructs such as what is engagement, well, this is what I think it is. But what we really want to do is say, well, this is the data that we have of what looks like engagement. And these are the factors that statistically stand out when we're measuring for this. So if we want a construct like engagement, we should operationalize it by understanding what the criteria is. So people may say, well, engagement, he looked like he was very interested. Well, behaviorally, cognitively, emotionally, socially, what does engagement look like? And how are we going to measure engagement? Is it just time on task?
because they may be very interested now, but they may not go back to it later. And thus, we may have piqued their interest, but I don't think we really have an agent. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
So what we really want to do is, when we're coming up with our measurements, we want to ground it statistically, not theoretically. So in many ways, one of the reasons why I brought in the idea of the brain fitness games is because in that case, what we're doing is we're using grounded statistics, grounded constructs for measuring spatial reasoning from a statistical sampling perspective. And we can do convergent and discriminant validity, which means that we know that people that have high spatial reasoning are good at this. We know that people who have poor spatial reasoning are not good at this. Sometimes people with high spatial reasoning have small working memory spans, and sometimes people who are not good at spatial reasoning have high. So we begin to say, well, these are elements that we've described statistically from this population, and we want to know if we put them into two different situations that they'll be bad at the things they're supposed to be bad at, and they'll be good at the things that they're supposed to be good at, because what we want to be able to do is say that what happened happened because we thought it would happen, and
right.
We designed it so that it would happen, and lo and behold, it happened. And that's an important idea when we begin thinking about design constraints and increasing the likelihood of the certainty within these types of situations. So you can construct your questions to be very broad, where you're just initially putting your toe in the water, or you can make them very constrained, and you can do convergent and discriminant validity, which is I know that somebody who has a lot of background playing games should be able to pick up this controller right away. I know somebody who doesn't should not, and you can create situations that will.
They're meant to rotate.
Cool.
Thank you. Yeah, thank
you. Thank you. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks for the printouts.
Sure.
It'll be really helpful later.
I hope they're useful, and you have my card, so please contact me if you have questions or if I can be of help. Also, did you have one?
Yeah.
No.
Jason,
could I have one?
Yeah, of course. Also, I'm an editor-in-chief at a game journal, and if you're interested in learning about reviews and publications, that's something that I'm very interested in connecting people with.
That would be great.
Yeah. Was there anything you're looking for?
No, if you want,
you can
Jason.
Okay, you're going to do an introduction again?
Yeah,
I'm going to reset.
Oh, yeah.
Game reset.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I take this copy?
Yes, of course. Good.
This time has $2,400.
Well, it's a general place to start. And
sure, this is,
I can get
one to check out Brock.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
I haven't met Brock. I don't remember your name.
You seem familiar.
Yeah. I'm a Swedish National Defense College in Sweden.
Well, I had a Fulbright in Norway, and I've been at different places in Scandinavia.
Yeah, but have you been involved with the GDC session before?
GDC?
No, at the Game Developers Conference. Or have you almost been affiliated with McMaster?
Well, I was at University of Minnesota before, and I I've been at a lot of different conferences.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
So, this is one of the things you're going to talk about?
This provides kind of a framework for me to, and also, I'm hoping it provides something that we can take with you.
I think you're trying to look like
Lucas.
Okay, you're just making Daniel.
Anybody want one of these packets?
Yeah, okay.
Many of us would love one of these
packets. All right, I've got lots of them. Thanks to Sony, they printed all these. Please thank them. I think I gave some people two. Because that one looked like a full set, and it was thinner than the other ones.
I think I may have to.
All right, break them up and share.
How many cases?
Hopefully the Lorax won't come in for my abuse of copying. Actually, could I? My sorting these is creating a bottleneck. Could I pass them around? And if you don't have one, you could. So this is the starting page. Also, I have cards. If you would like to contact me, please give me your card. So, how many of you have worked in a lab like this, where you have a kind of a naturalistic setting? So in many ways, this lab is intended to trick you into thinking that you're in your natural environment, right? So what we want to do is make you think that you're out in the wild somewhere, but really you're in a very controlled environment where we can answer the types of questions that we want to get information for. So in many ways, bringing somebody in, we want to get them comfortable as quickly as possible. One of the things that I want to share with this is that I work at a very different type of lab where it's a hybrid between an academic lab. If you see my card, I work for a university, but we do a lot of industry work. So we work with industrial partners like game companies, and so it's a little bit different than answering questions for theoretical or academic purposes. We actually want to not only improve the game, but we might also want to answer questions about the effects that this game or software has on the user. And that provides a little bit different situation. And being in a university context, what's really important is that we standardize protocols. And it has a number of benefits. One, it protects the participant. What we really want to do is guarantee the safety of the people that we bring in. Two, we want to protect our partner, the liability, and the people in our lab from liability. So if anything, we want to make sure that since there are cords in here, since there's this table, how do we make sure that nobody gets hurt? And through standardization, it means that we've thought through the process. So one of the things when you're working with a development team, one of the things that you want to be able to say in the process of working with them is, hey, that is a really good question. I thought about that, and this is how I thought I could deal with that. So what you really want to do is, it's like what my younger brother used to do when he wanted to play Monopoly. He'd say, the board's all set up, we're ready to play. And you know,
how can you say no?
Right. And the idea behind this is also, you want to have the board all set up before they come in. The more you've thought through this, the more freedom you're actually going to have. And that sounds counterintuitive, right? But the more standardized your protocols, the more valid and reliable your data, and the more likely you're able to replicate the collection of data across data, people collecting the data, people observing, and other labs doing the same thing with your protocols.
So if you send this out to different sites for localization, you have a standardized protocol for data collection, and you don't have to wonder whether or not the variations that you're seeing in the responses are due to implementation rather than sample subgroups, localization, or in many cases, just the way that you presented the situation and how you collected the data. So this morning, I'm from here originally, and this morning I got up at my uncle's house he had made me some coffee, and he pulled this cup down, and we filled it up, and he says, you know, you really ought to have a top on that. I said, you're right, but I'll be okay. And he put me in his daughter's, his daughter got a new car, so I've got her high school car. And anyway, I'd never driven it, so I put my cup of coffee down, and I've got my phone, and I'm on 880, and I went like and, of course, it was kind of like some evil hand had taken control of me and just dropped it in there. And, of course, now I no longer have touch screen access to my phone. But the idea behind that story is that I knew better. Bob knew better. I should have had a cover on this. And having these protocols in place... You know, if somebody trips over a cord or somebody hits a sharp corner on this, that's going to reflect back on you. You're going to feel bad if somebody doesn't come out of what your observation. If they come up hurt, emotionally abused, or feeling like they've been exploited, you're going to feel awful when you learn that. So the best thing to do is to really think through how this is going to work before you do it. So. That's why I kind of created this generic kind of outline. One of the things about our lab is we have a room like this. We have a fake office. We've got a fake apartment. And what we want to do is figure out, well, before we bring somebody in, what questions are we going to ask? What are we interested in? And the other part is we've got students who are being trained. So that means that we're going to have a range of people who are going to be running the experiment. So I consider this an experiment, and I consider the structure of this to be just like I would be doing an experiment in a vision lab or an experiment in a driving lab, right? So what we want to do is we want to say, I'm an experimentalist. I'm going to put on that hat. I'm going to create that persona. And what does an experimentalist do? Well, they control the situation so that there aren't a lot of unknowns happening. And when the unknowns do happen, it's interesting, right? And you can quickly turn that aberration into a feature, right? But so with this, our lab is also a little bit different in that, for example, one of the projects we're working on right now is brain fitness games. And it has two goals in mind, one of which is these brain fitness games are intended to improve cognitive performance in young people. So like brain games, like Lumosity, etc. In this case, they wanted to find out, well, does playing these games actually lead to evidence that there's cognitive enhancement? And the other piece is, okay, how do we make sure that people stay engaged with these games? Because with In order for us to have reliable and valid data, we have to have so much playing time. And if the students or the users don't play for an extended amount of time, we don't have enough data points in order to do analysis and comparisons, because we actually need to see significance and we want to see an effect size. So we are going to do quantitative analytics in order to see if the stimulus that we put in front of them led to an outcome. And in many cases, what we're going to do is we're going to say, okay, we want measurable ways to measure these constructs, such as what is spatial reasoning? Well, there are ways to measure that from intelligence testing. So let's take these standardized measures. Let's have them do them first. Let's then have them play these games. Let's check them middle of the way, have them do these batteries again. Let's do it at the end. Let's have another group play a game that shouldn't have any effect on spatial reasoning. And over time, let's see what their responses. Now let's have them switch, and let's see if in the A or B category there's a change in stage one versus stage two, and make a comparison not only within but across these participants. So in that way, what we're doing is a psychological experiment about spatial reasoning. But we have a second question. How are we going to get these kids to sustain engagement? And one of the things that we're interested in from the developers is, what is the value of feedback? And is the different way that we're creating feedback across these games having an impact on whether or not kids will maintain engagement and continue playing, giving us enough data points in order to do an analysis? So in many ways, what we're trying to do is say, does it work? And also, what is the thing that's making it work? And how can we actually improve the performance? Because we know that we may not have it right now, but each time we do it, we want to get better at it. So we have this iterative cycle, right? And that's a little bit different. But it's still the same. What you're doing is you're actually taking responsibility for the things that you're measuring, such as if you're measuring engagement, what does engagement look like? Is it just behavioral? Does it mean that they're paying attention to it? Well, there are actually five sub-traits to engagement according to the construct. There's behavioral, there's cognitive, there's affective, there's social, and there's the motivational piece. So how are you going to measure those things? And how are you going to know that the way that you're measuring them is not theoretical, which is, this is what I think it is, but rather, this is what I've observed, and I can support statistically, so that when I see it within my testing tool, that my data collection reflects engagement as a construct. So taking not only the user-centered approach, but also grounded psychological approach, not necessarily based upon theory, but statistical constructs and criteria. So we can integrate both of those. I've jumped really far ahead. And the reason why I explain that is that in those types of studies, we actually have to have different beginning protocols. And in order to do a study like what I just explained, you'll have submitted an application to an ethics review board or internal review board at a university. And I specialize in vulnerable populations like children and folks who are elderly and may have mild cognitive impairment, early stage Alzheimer's. So one of the reasons why I specialize in that is because I know how to do this part. And this is tedious, right? Mm-hmm. So you've got to do all of this in order to get this. And this is your license to drive, which is a certificate saying you have clearance to do this study. And by doing that, people say, oh my God, that's so tedious. Why would I ever want to do that? Because what it does is it standardizes your protocols in your lab. You don't have to have IRB clearance necessarily in everything that you do, but by going through that exercise, and in some ways what I've provided a general framework in here, you actually have a structure to point to if anybody wants to know how to replicate what you did, explain how you got the data that you did, or explain, what if you were in court and somebody says, well, Joe came in and he stubbed his toe, his nail came off, and he finds you liable for $300,000 for that toenail. It never grew back. Tell me about how Joe entered the lab. Well, this is the standard protocol, right? So when you begin to create this protocol, you've probably, and I should have made you one of these two, you've probably either got a development or a design team that has specific questions that they want to ask. But before you even get to that design, you've already got protocols in place about how you're going to welcome somebody in, how you're going to walk them into the lab, what the lab setup is, why it's set up like that, why you're bringing in like that, why you've designed your questions and your scenarios in this way. Because when you're questioned, you want to say, yeah, I thought about that, and this is what I put in place as a protocol. Because you want to have that answer, right? Especially when, say, well, yeah, that could have been because of this. Yes, I thought of that. And that's a really good point. And with that in line, you then can begin to go to the protocol, such as, okay, this is how I'm going to set up the session. Because we're a university lab, we've got students who are being trained, and they need to be able to do the same thing that everybody does. So if I have a sample of 132 people, and I have six groups, I'm going to want to make sure that if I have a number of different people running my experiment, they do it in the same way, right? With that, facilitator tips. We're going to design this in a way that allows us to have free-form data collection and also focused data collection. It depends upon what your goals are. This isn't specific just to games where you have playing and screen capture. One of the questions that was asked in the last session was, how about board games? Can that be done from this perspective? Yes. In fact, one of the tools that I use is what's called a causal network analysis, which is I want to look at a workflow, and I want to see what are the decision nodes, what causes what in the course of a game. And I want to be able to have kind of a map where I can say, I predict that such and such behaviors should come out of this situation. And these are the different states that this situation can occur in. And I would predict that if I tweak this, this will happen. If I don't tweak this, this will happen. And that's a lot of control that you can have. And you can say with some reliability that this is what's going to happen when this happens. It's kind of like hedging your bet with the people that you're asking the questions for, your design team. As a facilitator, the way that you say it is just as important as what you say. My first experience doing this type of work was as an intern, and I was told, we've done this online card catalog. This is at Xerox Park in, just up the road. And it was this thing called an online card catalog. This is in 1989, right? So anyway, I thought, oh my God, this is going to be boring. And of course it was, because what we were doing is having them do searches of books in the catalog. I thought, I can't keep doing this. I thought, this is kind of like Battleship. So I started thinking about, well, what if I were to do this in a way that was more fun for the people that were doing it? Would my data improve? And it did. So you can control the way that you interpret and present the activity. So presenting it as Battleship was a lot more fun for those involved and for me. And I got a lot better data. People opened up a little bit more, and we had a little bit of fun with it. But I had a protocol in place. So the way that you say it is just as important as how you say it. So you, in many ways, if you have multiple facilitators, you have to agree on how the script is going to be interpreted and presented. And you need practice sessions so that you have your act kind of coded before you start bringing in people in the first.
How many practice sessions will you do?
Till we get it right. So it may be one, it may be multiple. The key is that it also depends upon how many facilitators we have. So
I think those can really help. I never do practice sessions, and I usually have like 10 people coming in, and oftentimes the first two are a little rough, and sometimes they're a disaster, and friggin' disaster.
And that can be useful too. If you don't have a lot of time or resources, you may have to improvise on the run. But the more organized you are before going into it, the better off you are. So if you have that script in order to build from as an outline, or you have some very specific ways that you're going to approach it, so what if you want to go very open-ended? And it's not really about playing a game, but you're trying to elicit information about a process. The questions that you ask predict the type of answers that you get. So if I want to say, have you played this game before? I've got basically a yes and a no, right? Those are my two options. That can be useful. That's an analytic that I can compare across samples. or I can go from something like a phenomenological interview, saying, so this is a game that we're very interested in. Tell me about your experience with it. And I gather a lot different data. They tell me about their experiences. And I can still code it across different phenomenological aspects, such as time, space. I can do it from an ethnographic perspective. I can look at the causal explanationships and relationships within the narrative that they create. So there are a number of ways that I can conduct that. Another issue is paperwork. So I worked in a driving lab called Human First at the University of Minnesota. We had a Saturn in a theater with 360-degree road, and the rearview mirrors were LCDs and such, and we would oftentimes test. So one study was on road rage, and we wanted to see if certain personality types were more likely to go into road rage. So they would take an inventory beforehand. So we would have our script, we would be describing to them about the study without telling them what we were collecting. So in some ways, every study or every data collection has some degree of deception, because you're not going to necessarily tell them what you're looking for. And that's one of the things that you actually have to declare within your ethics, is what levels and what types of deception are you practicing within your data collection. And knowing that and placing that here helps you to avoid confounds, or when people say, what about this, and say, oh, I thought about that, and this is what I did in order to make sure that I was covered. So in the inventory, I should have a process for how I'm going to deliver that inventory and how I'm going to collect it. And that way, when people want to look at the chain of data, they know exactly how it was dealt with in each case. Right? So the more you have documented as a protocol process, the safer you are. And the way I started out is, you want to protect your subjects, you want to protect your lab, you want to protect your university, you want to protect your partners. So having all of this kind of detailed as a protocol is very helpful. It protects you and allows you a lot more freedom. In describing the ethics piece and talking about vulnerable populations, oftentimes we'll offer a letter of information about the study, and we'll describe it to them before they start. And with the vulnerable population, we'll be getting a sign-off or a consent form from a guardian. And with the vulnerable person, we'll have an assent form. So helping them to understand their participation is very important. It informs them of their legal rights. It tells them what they're going to be experiencing, what dangers they might be exposed to, and how we're going to collect data, how we're going to store data, and how we're going to destroy data or archive data, and how we're going to use data. So we may not go into that detail with the assent form, but for somebody who has to make the legal decision about participation, those things are really important, and those are really specified in the ethics or IRB. If you have those things in mind as you're bringing people in, your bases are covered. You say, I thought of that, this is what I did. So helping the participant understand their participation is very important. And once again, these surveys, what kinds of questions do you want to answer? And this is not only about answering your questions, but when you're beginning to build up a database for statistically informed categories, if you can actually get demographic information about their background and you create your database about your samples, you actually come up with a very robust database in order to inform the samples that you used over time. So that if you have permission to use that data for other analysis, you have very strong subgroup samples in order to make comparisons if you're doing other similar studies in the future. So,
can I ask a question about that? Because here, I mean, you actually have a disclaimer. It says no information from the survey will be linked to you in any way. So is all of that analysis that you do is blind to the actual individual participant?
In our lab, yes.
It is. Okay.
Yeah. So we actually have to anonymize and find ways to disassociate and aggregate the data away from the user. Yeah. And we can still create these subgroups and these databases of abstracted subgroups. So, for example, laser moms, right? Moms who like lasers.
Yeah.
You've got your subgroup, and you don't have to have any names on there. You've got your tasks described, and in for example, this application, I actually will have a very clear protocol of what the person's going to experience. I also have my explanation as to why I'm designing it in the way that I am.
Hey guys, sorry to interrupt. You're cool if you're going for as long as you want. Just FYI, if you weren't intending to attend any of the last sessions, they should be starting about now.
Okay. And then there's debriefing. So the whole idea behind this is the more organized you are before you start the game, you know, the less that you're going to have to compensate for during the game. So being really prepared ahead of time is really to your advantage. And it actually provides you a lot more freedom to improvise if things happen that you weren't expecting that you have to.